I want to introduce you to Mark and Kelly Baumgartner. They've been missionarying for 22 years in a place that I'm a little bit unfamiliar with. I have heard of the Canary Islands, and they minister on an island, in the largest one of those off of the coast of Africa. And they want to come today and share with us some of what they do, and they're going to be asking for our support and our prayers. And so I invite them to come now, or however they're going to do it, and give them a hand. Amen. They're part of the kingdom of God, and they're doing their work and they're in that part of the world. Amen. So, my friend, follow the Holy Spirit and go.
Thank you, Pastor. Isn't it nice to be in the house of the Lord? And how about the worship that we had this morning? Wasn't that marvelous? There's nothing easier than, yeah, thank you. There's nothing easier than coming and sharing the Word of God when people have set all of the atmosphere and led us into the presence of the Lord. Amen? Praise the Lord. Thank you for that. Kelly, come on for a second and just greet everybody. Would you give her a warm welcome?
Well, it is lovely to be here this morning. We would like to tell you just a little bit about us. We are, as Pastor said, we have been missionaries for 22 years. We've been 10 years in the Canary Islands. We spent the first 12 years in Africa, in Central Africa itself. We raised our children there. And we're just really grateful for what the Lord is doing. We have spent a year at home. Canyon Lake is home to us. We've been here for a year, although we haven't really been here for a year. We've been traveling around raising funds. We are what the military people now call short. So we are short. That means we have 8 days left until we get on the plane and get out of here for another 4-year term. And so the Lord has been really good to us and very faithful to us. And we're just so grateful for the opportunity to minister this morning. We want to invite you, when the service is over, to stop by the table. Some of you have already stopped by. In the big wooden hand, there are our prayer cards. Take those. Pray for us. It has our picture. It has some information about us. In the back, also, there's some information on our table. You'll find some books. I do purity conferences for teenage girls. I've done about 4 of them this year. There's some books about that on the table. We have T-shirts that are for our project. We have, as you may know, we raise support to go back just for ourselves, but we also have a project that we're doing. It's called Target 26. That is, we are trying to put one preaching point in the 26 counties on our island that have no evangelical work. So pray for that. There are T-shirts that go towards that project if you would like to support it. So we just covet your prayers, and thank you for being here this morning. May God bless you.
Amen. Thank you, Kelly. The wooden hand on the table has the prayer cards. Take all the prayer cards you want. Leave the wooden hand. Yes, I know it's beautiful. We tell everybody it's our right hand of fellowship, and where we got it, they did a lot of different carvings, and they actually had a right hand and a left hand, and I hesitated for 5 minutes to buy it. And I went back, and the left hand was already gone, so I just got the right hand of fellowship. But anyway, if you want one like that, then you have to make a trip out and see us. And I've extended an invitation to the pastor and to the team. If you guys like missions trips and like to get involved in the ministry that you pray and support, then that's certainly a possibility. Amen. A lot of people here that we're living in and ministering on islands, and they get this idea of the Hawaiian Islands. I don't know why that is, but people have this idea of what it must be like to live in islands or on islands. It's kind of like people from the big city that have an idea what it is like to live up a Canyon Lake. How many of you know the idea and the reality are not the same? Amen? Now, we love it because we live here. Amen? And we've learned, and some of us have stayed, but a lot of them have gone. And it's the same with islands. These islands, if you'll take a look at the map that we have when you go out, the big banner, you'll see that we're located just off the northwest coast of Africa. Now, how many of you have ever heard of the 1040 window? It's a geographical reference, longitude and latitude, and in that longitude and latitude are the greatest portion of the population of the planet that are lost and in need of the gospel. The islands fall into that. And they do, just because that's part of that same region. 99.5% of the population on the islands does not know Jesus Christ. Now, let me put that in terms that we can kind of relate to. Pastor, if you came and walked the streets of Tenerife, that's the big island, and you passed 200 people on the streets, statistically, possibly, you'd pass one believer. But the other 199 wouldn't know Jesus Christ. That's why God's called us there, and that's why we've been ministering the last 10 years, and we'll return to do another term there. We think that the best way to share with you what we've been doing, what we'll return to do, is in picture. All of you remember that picture paints 1,000 words, so we have a video presentation we've prepared, and we're going to see that right now. Can we start that over and put the sound with it?
Display for all to see. You are light, you are light. When the darkness closes in, you are hope, you are hope. You have covered all my sin. Is crippling. You are true, you are true. Even in my wandering, you are joy, you are joy. You're the reason that I sing. You are life, you are life. In you death has lost its sting.
Say amen to that. Now, in the big hand on the table, we have our prayer cards, a picture, and our contact information. Seems like the whole world's on Facebook. I know some of you aren't on Facebook. Sorry about that. But those of you are, you can friend us. The video is there also. You can see it. You can look at it. You can share it. But also in the photo albums, there are albums of pictures from the island and the work we do, and even still from Central Africa and the work we did when our children were growing up there. Amen. I want to share the word with you, and in doing so, share a bit of the work that we do and challenge you in missions. And I'd like you to open your Bibles with me, New Testament, the book of Matthew. Nowadays, it's more like saying open your tree book Bibles or turn on your e-book Bibles. Amen. The other day, I went to a church, and I was just visiting, and I brought my Bible on my cell phone, and muted the phone, but I had this great idea. Well, this will be handy, you know. And the teacher would hear with there, and as I was scrolling down, I thought I was going to have to go to the emergency room because of my thumb. It was like, so. But you open up whatever version you have. It's the Word of God, amen. Has the same power, the same authority, whether it's in stone, whether it's on paper, whether it's on parchment, or whether it's in an electronic form. It is God's Word, amen. Matthew chapter 22, if you will, follow along with me. Matthew chapter 22, this is the parable of the wedding feast. Matthew 22, starting with verse 1. And Jesus answered and spoke to them again by parables and said, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who arranged a marriage for his son. And he sent out his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding, and they were not willing to come. Ever invite somebody to the fellowship and they weren't willing to come? Hello? How many of you remember the day when we were invited and we were not willing to come? Hello? Aren't you glad people persisted? Aren't you glad they kept inviting us and kept praying for us? We're supposed to do the same thing. No, I've already invited them once. Yeah, I've told them. I'm not telling them again. I'm so glad people kept telling me again. Amen? And they were not willing to come. Verse 4, and again he sent out other servants saying, tell those who are invited, see I've prepared my dinner, my oxen and fatted cattle are killed, and all things are ready. Come to the wedding. Invitation after invitation, right? Verse 5, but they made light of it, and they went their ways, one to their own farm, another to his business. The world continues to do today what the world did back then. Everything else is more important, and you can't expect it to be any different. We did that until we got saved. We need to remember that. Verse 6, and the rest seized his servants, treated them spitefully, and killed them. But when the king heard about it, he was furious, and he sent out his armies, destroyed the murderers, burned up the cities. Then he said to his servants, the wedding is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy. Can I tell you something? We're part of the kingdom of God, but we weren't any more worthy or worthy now than we were before. But by the love and the grace and the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ, we got in. Amen? And remember this, when you're evangelizing and you're ministering to people, you don't decide, well, I'll invite them because they're worthy. Nope, they're not worthy either. But we're going to continue and love them and invite them anyway, aren't we? Amen. And it continues, verse 9, therefore go into the highways, and as many as you find, invite to the wedding. As many as you find. Wait, they're a bit ugly. I'm not inviting them. No, their boots are dirty. I'm not inviting them. No, they're mean. How? What's a mean one? Think, I'm not inviting them. I don't want them to come to my church. It's not our church, is it? And aren't you glad that some of us, though we were ugly or mean or had dirty boots or whatever it was, that God let us come in? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Verse 10, so those servants went out into the highways and gathered together all whom they found, both bad and good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. So turn to the one beside you and say, are you the bad one or are you the good one? Y'all be truthful now. Be truthful now. Verse 11, but when the king came in to see the guests, he saw a man there who did not have on a wedding garment. You know what? A lot of times when we study parables and we read about it, we jump over this verse and nobody talks about it. And it's something that I'm going to share with you this morning because it really has an important message for the church and the mission of the church and for each of us individually. So he said to him, friend, how did you come in here without a wedding garment? And he was speechless. Then the king said to the servants, bind him hand and foot, take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen. God bless the reading of the word. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Would you pray with me? Father, I thank you for the word today. I thank you for the message you have. And Father, we know that nobody came to hear from a man. They came to hear from you, from the Spirit of the living God. And Father, simply put, that means that we want you to touch our ears and our hearts, open our spiritual ears to hear and to receive. And Father, touch your servant that every word I speak would glorify you and be edifying to everyone in the sound of my voice. Father, I prayed in the name of Jesus Christ and by the blood of the cross of Calvary. And all of God's people said, amen. This parable, the great wedding banquet, if you will, it's really got cedar fever, as you might imagine. Isn't that funny how you live right up in the middle of the stuff you have? I told my wife, I said, we got a little acre of property up here. I said, I'm cutting down all my cedars, and when my neighbors aren't looking, I'm cutting theirs down too. Better not do that, should I? I'm telling you, got a lot of work. I don't think that's happening. This parable talks about this great day. It's looking for that moment that either by death or by rapture that we're going to be up there together. And I've studied the parables time and time again, but the last time I took a look at this parable, the Lord really impressed upon me the role that it plays in the mission of the church and the purpose that we have as a body of believers and as individuals. And I thought, Lord, I don't see it. You'll have to show me what it is you're trying to say. And he really, if you will, he opened my eyes to see something that I'd not seen. Oh, I saw the typical things, and I saw the normal things. But he really opened my eyes to see something that I want to share with you this morning. It was always there. It's always been there. But he helped me see it in a brand new way. And Kelly and I, when we were preparing last year to come home stateside, we stood in the International Church, and it's a bilingual congregation of about 15 nationalities. And you never know when you talk to somebody just which language you're going to speak. You think that everybody will speak English or Spanish, and that's the makeup. But oftentimes they don't speak either. And you marvel that they're in that church. And they say, but the Spirit of God is here. And I can feel that, and that comes across. And by translators, people will speak. We speak a lot of languages, but sometimes you just can't speak enough languages. And by the way, ¿cuántas personas aquí hablan español? Levanta la mano. If you don't know what I said the pizza's coming shortly. I didn't say that. The islands officially pertain, while we're geographically in Africa, they pertain to Spain. It's an autonomous region, so the official language on the island is Spanish. And I grew up in San Antonio speaking bad English and bad Spanish, a good Tejano boy, you know. And but on the island, they also speak a little bit of English, a little bit of German. And Kelly and I speak Spanish and English and French and an African dialect. And this gal has already started to learn German. Maybe we'll learn how to pronounce my last name. You never know. I stood in the pulpit of the International Church as we were preparing to come stateside, and I said this to them. And I really think that Pastor, this pertains to this body of believers as well. Lost souls hang in the balance. And what we do now will affect the destiny of lost people. Let me say that again. Lost souls hang in the balance. And what we do now will affect the destiny of lost people. You see, when you think about the purpose and the mission of the church, And all that God has called us to do, you realize that there's something at play here. You realize that we're talking about people who don't know Christ, who were in the same position that we were however long ago it was. For some of us, it could have been months or just a couple of years. For others of us, it may have been a lifetime. And I'm concerned sometimes for those of us that have been in the kingdom a long time, and I'm included, that we forget what it was like to be on the other side, that we get caught up in our church dialect and our lingo, and we fail to communicate with a lost and dying world in a way they can understand. I have a friend, every time somebody asks him how he is, he says, I'm supernatural. And they're lost people that are looking and scratching their head and thinking, he's a fruitcake. And he may be supernatural. He may be wonderful, but they don't get it. And I'm not into trying to turn people off and close them down. I want to open them up. I want them to be able to see we can build a friendship and a relationship so that we have an opportunity to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Can you say amen to that? Amen. And so in the text, as the Lord was unraveling it for me, there's several things I saw. One of them was the provision was made. Verse 1 and 2, you got the king. And you know the parables are telling a story. So it's talking about God. And God's preparing this great wedding banquet, right? This great day that will be up there. When we celebrate, when we're led into worship and praise of the Lord, that's a miniature of that great fiesta, if you will. And ladies, how many of you are going to have a party and you tell your husband, let's have a party, but let's not invite anybody? You don't do that. You invite people because it's something you want them to come. And how many of you, when you get invited to the party or a party, one of the first things we ask is, can I bring a friend? Can I invite some people? What can I do? We're all excited. We all want to participate. And that's the whole idea of this great day, this wedding banquet. God doesn't just want to throw this banquet. He doesn't want it just to be the greatest. He wants us all to come and say, can I bring somebody? Amen. And that's part of what we're supposed to be doing, bringing somebody. Praise the Lord. Provision was made. The first provision that was made was, of course, it's a wedding banquet. You got to have a bride. You got to have a groom. So Jesus Christ was the first provision. And we all know he's the groom, the bridegroom, if you will, according to the word. And the bride? The body of Christ. Amen. Now we say the church, and sometimes we get confused because we thought, wow, beautiful. But we all know, don't we, that we're the church. We're the body of Christ. Now, us fellas, we're kind of a little bit squirmish about being called the bride. But when you think about it as the body of Christ, we understand we're part of that. Amen. And here's the thing in that provision then that was made for this wedding banquet for a bride and the groom is the church. And when you break it down individually, that's me and you. You see, the Word of God says in Colossians, it's Christ in you that is the hope of glory. So turn to your neighbor and say, it's Christ in you that's the hope of glory. Now I want you to think about this. Christ in you is the hope of glory. And we live among a lost and dying world of people who have no hope. Hello? And so if Christ is shining in you, if Christ is the salt and the light in you that he ought to be, then they can see that hope and they can say, there's something different. What is it? I want to know. Amen. That's part of the provision. You and I are part of the provision. Wait a second. You say, no, our pastoral team, they're to do it. The elder board, they're to do it. No. You heard of the Great Commission, right? Does it say, Pastor Jerry, this great commission is for you? Does it say, Mark and Kelly, this great commission is for you? No, it doesn't have a name. In fact, when you read it, it's personalized because God intends it to be for every one of us. Every one of us. And the great commission, when we fulfill it, is what makes the difference for those who are hanging in the balance, for those who will hear the gospel and respond, and those who will not hear. Now listen, I know there are some who will hear and not respond. And God's a gentleman. He doesn't force people. Our job is to tell them. We can tell them and we can tell them again. We can knock and we can keep knocking. But at the end of the day, he's a gentleman and each person has the opportunity to choose. And the fact of the matter is some people make poor choices. Some of them are our kids. Some of them are our family members. Some of them are our friends. We're thankful to have children that have grown up in the Lord, but have continued to make good choices and stay in the Lord. But we have friends who raised their kids right in the Lord, and they're brokenhearted today because some of them made bad choices and they've wandered away. And somehow they tear themselves up and feel they've done a bad job and said, listen to me. The Word says you raise them up in the way they should go. You do that. They'll not forget. I said, but God is still giving them the opportunity to choose. And we want them to come back and we'll pray for them. But God doesn't force anybody. It doesn't mean you did a bad job. You just keep praying. You just keep believing. You just keep taking them to the throne room of heaven. Amen? You do that because we're part of the provision that God made. Speaking of that provision, I want to show you a couple things. You know, let's put that tree up there. The islands are very unique. And most of you probably have never been out there, maybe never will. But there's a tree. 13 islands there are in the Canary Islands. Tenerife is the biggest of the islands. 8 of the islands have populations. The island furthest out in the Atlantic is called the island of El Hierro, where this tree grows. The significance of the island of El Hierro is in the days of Christopher Columbus, when he set sail to discover the New World, he got his supplies out of the islands because it was the furthest out, this island, the furthest out in the Atlantic. In his day, that island was the ends of the earth. Sailors didn't sail out of sight of the island because they thought they'd go. Now, Columbus didn't believe that. Ironically, most of the sailors with him did. You know, that takes a lot of nerve to get on a ship that you think is going to sail right off the planet. On this island of El Hierro grows this tree. God planted that tree there. It's in the juniperus family. Yes, it's related to the cedars. There are certain times of year I don't want to be on that island. But in the place where the Lord planted these trees are extreme conditions. Most of the little saplings are just blown away. And the ones that grab hold, they take root and they put the roots down deep because life and the conditions are going to throw everything at them. And the extreme conditions and the wind take the little saplings, twist them, and then bend them over. And they thrive. They continue to grow. There's very few of them, but that's the most popular one on the island. The interesting thing is, isn't that what we're supposed to be doing in Christ? Isn't that what we're supposed to do? Put our roots down where God has planted us. And whatever the world throws at us, whatever trials, whatever tribulations come, we take them and let them add, do nothing but serve to add character to us. Do you know people come from all over the world to see that tree? Nobody goes to the island and says, I don't care about the tree. It's like, where is that tree? I want to see it. You see, if it was just an ordinary cedar, people would think like I do. Let's cut that baby down. Because come December, it's going to make me sick. But because it's done what it's supposed to do, where it's been placed, then it has character. And it stands strong. And it serves the purpose that God wants us to serve as well. Amen? Put the flower up there. The same island grows this flower. It's in the succulent plant family. And it's called the Granovia flower. No problem. What I want you to notice about the flower, kind of looks like it's planted right where that cross is, right on the... There we go. The Granovia flower. You see any dirt there? You see any soil there? God's planted it. It thrives. It grows right out of the rock. It's the most amazing thing. I've looked close at the variety of flowers and looked, and it just comes right out of the rocks. And it thrives. What's more is the particular part of the island that it grows on, there's not enough rainfall for that type of plant to be there. But because of the altitude, it grabs its moisture out of the low-lying clouds. God planted it there. It's growing on the rock and it's thriving because the provision that was made for it, it took it and it said, you know what? I'm going to thrive here. And that's what Jesus Christ wants you and I to do. Can you say amen to that? Amen. Provision was made. First in Christ and then in the body of Christ. And you and I individually, because Christ is in us and he's the hope of glory. Take a look furthermore. Lord showed me something again in the third and fourth verses and repeated throughout the text, is that people were invited. In fact, if you look, there's no less than three, probably the inference of four or five times that people were invited to the same wedding banquet. And anywhere in Scripture that there's a repetition of the same thing, God's trying to get our attention. So he invites them. And he invites them again. They ignore him and they go do other things and he invites them again. Then he tells them, go out and search for them, find them, and he invites them again. And everybody is invited. And the whole idea is that you and I have a job to do, and that's to tell a lost and dying world about Jesus Christ. Amen. Now listen to me. I didn't say we have a job to do and that's to invite them to church. A natural result of what we're supposed to do will see them in the body of Christ. Amen? But the invitation that we're supposed to give is an invitation to know Jesus Christ. I know some of you saying, but Brother Mark, I'm not a preacher. Brother Mark, I'm not a teacher. Brother Mark, I'm shy. Brother Mark, I tell them the Bible says, and they say, I don't believe in the word. I tell them Jesus said, and it's like, tell it to the hand. But the thing that you're supposed to be sharing with them, they'll listen to. You know what that is? It's your history. You say, what? Yeah, your testimony. It's what Christ has done in you and continues to do. Because that's your story. And I know somebody told me the other day, they said, I don't have an interesting story. Yeah, you do. Because Christ continues to work in you. It's not a done thing. It's not finished. My wife grew up in the church. She probably, the first week she was alive, was in a little baby carrier under the pew. And she could, some people would say, she doesn't have an interesting testimony. I'm telling you, the girl has an interesting testimony. Because she understands what Christ has done and continues to do in her. Amen. You and I do too. And our task then is to tell people about what Christ has done in us. It'll contain the word. It'll contain the testimony of Jesus Christ and salvation. And they really can't deny it because they have to listen because they're seeing a living example. Amen? What's neat, you don't have to run out to Walmart and get more invitations because you never run out. You never run out. All you have to do is go and say, did you get your invitation? Did you get your invitation? How about you? Did you get your invitation? Because you have it to share. Sometimes when we're speaking with people who don't know Christ, we get hung up on talking about all the wrong things. And we talk politics, and we talk weather, and we talk this and that, and boy, ain't that cedar pollen strong. That cedar fever's killing me. Hello? Sometimes, I told my wife the other day, she finally got me to take a pill. I've been saying, nah, just give me an investment in Kleenexes. But I was thinking and laughing yesterday. It's like, I better take that pill or I'm not going to be able to speak and share nothing with nobody. We can talk about a lot of different things with people, but we cannot fail to share the gospel of Christ with them. That's the most important thing that we can share. And we have to. That pearl of great price, have you found it? And what are you doing with it? Ladies, last time I checked, when your man gives you a pearl necklace, you don't say, oh, this is beautiful. I think I'll put it away in the safe. This is beautiful. I think I'll hide it away in this little satchel under the sock drawer. No way. What do? You put it on and you show it and you let people know. And God compares our salvation and what we find in Christ as a pearl of great price. Amen. It's something we want to share with people, not in a braggadocious way, but this is what Christ has done and is doing in me. And he wants to do the same in you. Amen. That's what we're supposed to share with the world. Let me see that. You got that right there. Some people will say, I've been traveling around with this for a year. I just about broke it this morning. Kept it in bubble wrap for a whole year. And the moment I need it, I throw it on the floor. It's a little stronger than I thought. Some of you are saying, I'm just too timid, I can't do this. I tell a story about a little boy who was walking the sands of the shore. I don't know how many of you have walked the sands and you've actually braved touching a live starfish. They won't hurt you. They're kind of creepy feeling. But he did. And he's walking the sands, and he noticed a large number of starfish washed up. And he just started picking them up one at a time, because you know they dry out, they die. And he just started picking them up one at a time, tossing them in. Picking them up one at a time, tossing them in. A businessman happened to be watching him. He's thinking, that boy's wasting his time. I'm going to teach him a lesson. And so the boy's picking them up, tossing them in, and the man goes, son, don't you realize you're wasting your time? And the boy just continues one at a time, one starfish, picking it up, tossing it in. He said, there are thousands of starfish washed up and down these shores. You can't possibly hope to make a difference. You're wasting your time. And the boy continues to pick them up. And he said, son, didn't you hear me? I said, you can't hope to make a difference. And he picks up one more starfish, and he tosses it in. And he says to the man, it made a difference to that one. And he left the man there speechless, and he continued to pick up more. And each time he says, now, and it made a difference to this one. And he tosses another one in, and he says, and it made a difference to that one. And that is what God wants us to do. Yeah, I know we think in terms of we need to win the whole county. We need to win a whole city. We need to win our neighborhood. We need to win our entire family. Listen, what you need to do is win the one single starfish at a time that God sent your way. To be faithful in that. And he'll do the rest of the work. Did you know that one of the greatest evangelists that the world's ever seen came to Christ because of one individual? One individual. She was a woman in a denomination that doesn't appreciate women in ministry. And ironically was in ministry, in Sunday school. I don't know if she shared with anybody else, but a woman Sunday school teacher brought Billy Graham to Christ. How much credit does she get to share? How many jewels on her crown will she get? Because we know what Billy Graham did. Did she bring the entire classroom? I don't know. Did she ever bring anybody else to Christ? I don't know. But I know she brought Billy Graham to Christ, and I know what Billy Graham did. And he wants to do the same with us, because you do not know what God will do with that individual, with that person. Amen? Let's continue on. My third and final point, those old tree book Bibles, at least they never turn themselves off. Provision was made, people were invited, and then you find in the 5th and 6th verse and the 11th and 12th verses something quite interesting. You find that prudence was lacking. We don't use that word so much. It's used a lot in the Old Testament, in Psalms and Proverbs. But let me define it for you. Prudence is defined as wisdom applied to practical matters. I want you to think about that. Wisdom applied to practical matters. Now, where do we get wisdom from? The Word says that wisdom comes from on high. Amen? And the greatest source of wisdom we have is where? In the Word of God. So he gives us that word. So if wisdom is applied to practical matters and God's giving you his wisdom in the Word of God and you use it like the ointment the doctor gave you for a scratch, you buy it, you take it home, you throw it in the medicine cabinet and you go, man, that scratch, that itch, that rash is still there. Well, did you apply the ointment? No. But I bought the cream. Hello? Did you grab your Bible this morning and have to go? I can't say that on the islands because the Sahara Desert sands blow so much that every morning you go. Every single morning, sometimes twice a day. God's intention with his word is that he's poured out the wisdom for us. We have it, but we have to apply it. We have to use it. We have to say, Lord, that fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, and the others that are mentioned there, how do I live that out in such a way that I can see it and others can see that in me? How can I apply that? How can I live this out? And that's what God wants. Here's the interesting thing. When we were in the world, we didn't get it either. And the people we're surrounded that don't know Christ, that need to know him, they don't get it. When you invite them to church or you share with them about the gospel, and it's not that they don't come because they lack the ability most of the time, but rather they lack the knowledge that you and I have in Jesus Christ. Amen? We have that prudence. We have that wisdom applied to practical matters. They're careless with their souls because they don't know any better. And we didn't know any better either when we were in the world. But this is where we can make a difference. Partly by being careful with our own souls and caring about theirs as well. Caring about them as individuals, caring about their salvation, caring enough to tell them and tell them again, caring enough to invite them to coffee, caring enough to say, hey, we have this special activity, whether it's vacation Bible. I love vacation Bible school. If you guys ever want to do vacation Bible school on the other side of the planet, then you let me know. We love vacation Bible school. But those are the kinds of activities, different things that maybe you can't get somebody Or maybe they're not so open about coming to church or coming to the main service. So invite them to something else. Invite them to a ladies' meeting. Invite them to a men's meeting. Invite them for a cup of coffee. Have them come for dinner. Love them to Christ. Love them to Christ. And it'll make such a huge difference in their life. Just the same way that people took the time to bring us to Christ. We can make a difference. So I told you that I was going to mention that guy that showed up in the wedding banquet and had a wedding garment on. That guy, and if you read the context, it's quite interesting because the king said, how did you get in here? And so if in between the lines you understand that there's the implication you shouldn't have been able to get in. So how did you get in? So that means somebody probably had the task of being at the door, said, no, you got to be changed. You got to have a wedding garment. Because the idea, of course, is when we come in to the church, we come into the Lord and we become changed, right? So he knew that he was supposed to be, but he didn't. So he waited until the guy at the door probably was distracted, and he snuck in. And he ran to the food and he ran to the drink because he knew he wasn't supposed to be there. And sooner or later, he's going to get found out. Ever heard of wedding crashers? Ever heard of potty crashers? That really does happen. Any of you ever do that? No, don't raise your hand. You know what that represents? The guy without a wedding garment represents hypocrisy. Now, hypocrisy isn't limited to the church. Some people think so. They're wrong. Hypocrisy is in every sector of the world. It is. It's in every business. It's in every neighborhood. It's there. People who are just not what they're supposed to be and are trying to pretend to be something. The interesting thing about hypocrisy is because the church functions on this earth, then we can find it in the church as well. But a hypocrite never fools God. That's the interesting thing. Hello? We never fool God. A hypocrite will never fool God. Also, a hypocrite will fool himself much longer than anybody else around him. And that's the danger. You see, in Ephesians 11, when it talks about communion, one of the things it says is that we should examine ourselves. Because if you're not right, it says you don't want to partake if you're not right. People have the idea there then, well, I better not take it. No. In the same context, it says examine yourself. Why? Because the goal is to get yourself right, to pray and say, God, cover this. Take care of this. Make me clean. I want to be right. And then participate in the blood and the body of Christ. Amen. And that's what the Lord wants us to do on a regular basis, is to examine ourselves so that we don't continue fooling ourselves. That we can be all that we're supposed to be. That we can be the salt and the light that we're supposed to be. Revelation 3:16, because you are neither hot nor cold, but lukewarm, I'll spew you out of my mouth. Literally, it's vomit you out. And the implication there is that God wants us to be on fire for him or not even play games. Just forget it. Because when we play those games and we're lukewarm, the world looks at us and then they say, if that's what it is, I don't want it. I don't want people to see my life and say, if that's what it is, I don't want it. But rather to say, you've got something. I see a hope in you. The Christ in you is the hope of glory. And know that we can make a difference. And all it takes is for us to say, Lord, cleanse me. Make me new. Doesn't mean I'm not going to fall down and make a mistake. Doesn't mean you won't have a problem. But you get back up, you brush yourself off, and you say, Lord, I want to go on with you and I want to do a better job in your name. Amen. That's what he wants us to do. I want to finish with this picture. Go ahead and put that last picture up. We told you that our children grew up in Central Africa. If you can enlarge that one a little bit, it'll be easier to see. Our children grew up in Central Africa, in Equatorial Guinea. And not far from there is the Sudan, where this picture came from. It came from one of the first conflicts. You know, Sudan's been in conflict and in toil and strife for some time, but it came from the first conflict, and a photographer journalist group went out to try to tell the story to the world. And you know, they're professionals, they have a job to do, and they know if they get the right picture and they can put a story with it, they can communicate. And each profession has its prizes, and if you get the right photograph, you can win a prize. So this photographer tells a story about taking this picture and how he was in one of these rescue stations, and he goes out down a trail. And if you've set foot on sub-Saharan Africa, you know that a lot of their roads are just trails into the bush, and they're dry and dusty in the dry season, and in the rainy season they're just mud patches. And they're going out and down this dry trail, and they come upon this Sudanese girl. If you look close, you can see she's on her hands and knees, very malnourished. She's heading towards the rescue station. Somebody's told her, go there. There's help there. And you see what's behind her? The vultures behind her. You know what vultures eat. And they eat dead things. The vulture's there waiting to get the meal that the girl wished she had. The photographer tells a story in his own words about seeing this picture, seeing this little girl and realizing that's it. He gets out of the vehicle and he tells his crew, they set up their stuff, and he tells in his own words how he took 20 minutes, Pastor, 20 minutes. He said, I needed 20 minutes. Where can I get this right angle? He's watching this vulture behind this girl who's malnourished. And he's thinking about the picture. Let me just see if I can get the right angle. And he's thinking in his mind, this is the picture. I'll take this one and I'll win that prize. 20 minutes later, he snaps the shot. He knows he's got it. And he tells the crew, that's a wrap, man. Grab everything and let's go. And they head back to the camp and they've taken the picture. And they left the little girl. He won the prize for that photograph. And he lost a lot more. What's the natural question when you see that? And what about the girl? He couldn't answer that. He didn't know. Because people said, does she live? He didn't know. You see, folks, the longer we're in the church, the more danger there is of us getting a picture and maybe putting a story with it and forgetting that we have it in our hands to reach down and love people and bring them in, to wrap a coat around them or a blanket around them. They were going back to the rescue station, Pastor. They were going back to the very place this little girl was crawling to. And you and I need to help people. Every time we meet a person who doesn't know Christ, maybe they're not even smart enough to be heading to a rescue station, but we can help them and we need to help them. Fine, take the picture, understand the story behind it, but reach out a helping hand and love them into the gospel of Jesus Christ. Can you say amen to that? That is what the Lord wants to do in us. Can I have you come back to your guitar? Would you do that? I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes, no one looking around. Just whatever beautiful music comes out of there. No one looking around, just for a moment. You know what? If you're here this morning, and maybe you're a visitor, if you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, the greatest thing you could do this morning is say, you know what? I want to know about this Jesus. There's a pastoral team here, and they'll be glad to know, so you don't leave here before you've talked with them. But if all heads bowed, eyes closed, no one looking around, if you're here this morning and you say, I want to accept the Lord, or maybe you just want to rededicate your life to the Lord, give it back and say, I've been far away, I want to come back, just slip a hand up. Let me know, and I'll pray with you. Just slip a hand up. I won't embarrass you. Amen. Any others? Amen. Any others? Any others? Nobody be embarrassed. Just slip a hand and say, that's me. Pray for me. I want to come back. Amen. Amen. Heavenly Father, you've seen the hands and you know the hearts of your people and even perhaps, Lord, those who didn't raise a hand. Father, I ask that you wash them in the blood of the Lamb, that you cleanse them of their sins, forgive them, Lord. And Father, today let them come in. And Lord, they accept you. They thank you that God sent you to die on the cross and 3 days later to rise again. We thank you for the forgiveness and the cleansing that happens, Lord God. Father, make them new creatures today. For the rest of us here this morning, maybe you'd say, you know what you've shared, Brother Mark, has moved me, and I think I can do a better job. And with the Lord's help, I want to do a better job. I want to be that witness. I want to be that individual who gives an invitation, And with the Lord's help, I want to do a better job. Would you lift your hand with me? Because that's my desire. Just say, lift your hand and say, Lord, I want to do a better job. With your help, I'll do a better job. Amen. Across the sanctuary. Lord, start with me. Father, you've seen the hands, and you know the hearts of your people. And Father, indeed, start with us. Lord, that we can do a better job. Father, we can't do it alone, but in your strength, with your help. Father, when we see people, Father, that we'll be compassionate, that we'll look beyond the chunk of coal and see a diamond in the rough, just as you looked and saw that in us and others, Lord God. Father, give us the strength, the courage, the compassion, the passion to do this, Lord, because all around us are people who need help. All around us are people who need a helping hand. All around us are people who need Jesus Christ. Father, open our eyes that we might see it. Father, bless this body of believers. Bless the pastoral team. I thank you for them. Thank you for the hearts. I thank you for what they're doing in this community. Father, with Pastor Jerry, everything he sets his hand to, bless, Lord God. His rising up and his sitting down, Lord, his coming in and his going out. Bless this, your body, in Jesus' name. Amen.